tonight's, I'm going to call it Hopkinton Town Council Workshop, July 31st, 2017, to order. Open a workshop to discuss and consider the following: proposed farm viability ordinance amendments submitted by the Hopkinton Conservation Commission. Chairman Harvey Buford's in the audience. Harvey, any other members here tonight? I see John.
Yes, I'm with you.
Oh, so you got three members.
Gary was planning on being here. I didn't talk to Deb, but I think she was going.
Okay.
She kind of waits.
I don't think so.
So we may have two showing up yet.
Okay. So Harvey, as we all know, Harvey had sent a letter to us outlining some proposed amendments to the farm viability ordinance. It looks like there's four items. So if we can, we'll just take them one at a time and go back and forth and see what we come up with. The first is we allow for a limited crop farm of 80,000 square foot that is smaller than the existing entry point of 5 acres. I guess, and I'm not sure, we'll have to, anything we can't answer, I guess tonight we'll have to just try and get answers as we progress through. But first thing that jumps out at me is how many of these crop farms are in town, I guess. I have no idea. So if we limit it instead of 5 acres to 80, 2 acres basically, how many does that include? That's the one preliminary question that I have. So.
Take notes.
Yeah. So.
Is this a dialogue kind of?
Yeah.
Page.
Well, we're gonna take one item at a time. So we're on that minimum square footage, dropping it down from 5 acres to basically 2.
Right. I know of one offhand because one farm that meets that criteria was at the meetings to define this. It's also geared toward thinking forward. I know that younger people starting out, they're farming in big ways. They can do indoor farming, hydroponic farming, on just a half an acre provide a significant yield of different crops. So it's not only to include those who may be a little bit out of alignment with the existing ordinance, but also doing good efforts.
Okay. Is there any concern, because we are a rural community, that a number of people will decide their farms? Because one person stays home and I'm a farm and I have 2 acres and I don't have to pay my rural tax, I'm now a farm, and 2 acre zoning all over town. I mean, I have a bit of a concern on, I understand where you're going, mm-hmm. You can indeed have a farm on 2 acres, but I'm concerned that most of our zoning is 2 acre, and anyone and their brother could say, hi, I'm a farm, and get farm taxes, not their normal taxes, and we would suddenly get an enormous truck income.
Just one thing on that. I think to qualify for the farm portion open space, you have to have
10 acres
plus your house size. So a small, somebody like that doesn't qualify for that tax.
And is it 2 acres of farmable land or 2 acres with your house on it, so maybe you only have half an acre of farmable land? That's what you're doing. You're saying it's a 2 acre farm, which means the house, the barn, the outbuilding, and then they may have another little space they consider a farm.
Again, if you think of, we try to actually talk to people who really wanted something specific that we're here. I wish the Grace would make it here. She's going to be late. So, but their example there at the corner of Penobscot Road,
like that's
three.
Farm.
That's 2 acres total.
Right. No, I understand.
Their property is 2 acres, and they've got that little operation in there, and
they can't
call
themselves.
How they deal with the zoning and everything, I don't quite know, but it's. I look at that as, well, is that something the town likes or dislikes? And it seemed to be that popular, and people like it, like knowing it's there. You question how many of these there are, those are the kind of questions that you obviously need to be asking. Is there somebody else that they did it would be very unpopular?
Right.
There's an example where it is popular, I believe.
Yeah, but my concern is like rabbits can grow on 2 acres. And I know we've had a problem with that before on zoning, because you can have rabbits on 1 acre, and, but then you're butchering them, and, you know, you're now in an R1 zone, not an R480 zone.
And we called it a crop farm, with the idea that we were trying to distinguish it from
It's a crop.
Animal farms, and we could certainly be more specific, I suppose, on
It's like in,
That, because the animals animals on 2 acres could very quickly, you know, become an issue.
Right, because we have the pig farm on Route 91, which is a couple of acres. So I'm a little concerned if that shouldn't be a little more specific. And also how much they're expected to make, because if they're a farm, I think they should make enough money to survive. Which is about 2,500, which is not enough for anyone to survive. Yeah, I assume they have that as well. I'm a little concerned about, I understand Festival Farm and I like it very much. I think it's a great idea. But I have a feeling that as soon as you start making farms tinier and tinier, it might end up causing a real problem with R1 zones, residential zones, and R80 now. You know, you're might as well be in R1. So I'm a little concerned about it. I think it needs to be a little tight.
If you want to start with the first page,
I think it's good to do like
a number of questions. For instance, the crop farm. On these farms, which are, if I'm reading everything right, which includes the crop farm, they can do farm products and they can create farm-related products. And I believe that it states on the page. If you include this letter, let's say the third page in of the document, in the middle it says upon any crop farm, it's a section of 553, farm-based retail. That's where it's 553, and down under 4B, it states that upon any crop farm is defined. Retail sale activities listed below are uses permitted by right, and that is farm products and farm-related products. So you go back to farm products and farm-related products and make sure you understand that on these 80,000 square feet. And I mean, practicality is going to cut some things down, but it allows for these two items and, farm product and farm-related products. Those are the two, which would be allowed on a crop farm. So you want to think about what it is we would allow on a crop farm, and maybe not those two definitions. Maybe there's a separate definition for the crop. I don't know, but you want to think of, there's a lot to think about.
I'm still trying to find where you are.
Page four.
It's
section 5-53.
Up there.
I'm sorry. It's 552. I'm on 552, and then I refer to 553, and it's 4B, and it says where the crop farm can do these activities by right.
Okay.
So, do we really want 80,000 square feet to be able to have products other than farm products as defined above, which are built, constructed, or manufactured on the farm, such as crafts, articles, clothing, quilts, finished products, wood products? That doesn't sound so bad. You get to the one above it, and it's all agriculture, horticulture. I'm not even sure what that is.
Eggs, dairy products.
I don't know what that means.
Is that a title?
I don't even know what that word is.
Which one?
Oh, I'm reading the definition of farm product. Farm-related vegetable fruit.
Like you're going to be growing trees.
Oh,
no, the next word.
I meant silviculture. I know silviculture before.
I guess it's related to trees.
But you know, so there's a lot there. Livestock products, compost, on and on and on and on. So
2 acres not fine.
That might not be okay. Down below, on the same page, where it says 552, and the last one, it says farm supplemental dwelling. And it appears, the way I'm reading, that would be also allowed on a crop farm. Now, you've got 80,000 square feet. most homes that have a lot, whatever size it is, they have, usually have a septic and a well. So most of the town has a septic and a well. Now, if you're going to allow a supplemental dwelling, most of these lots are already established. You already have a farmhouse or you have a house. You already have a septic. Most septics are three bedroom. So how are they going to have a supplemental dwelling? Are they going to put in another septic on 80,000? So that
they're not allowed a septic on large farms.
Can you show me where it says that?
Yeah, I will.
Oh, good. Okay.
Yes.
If it's in here and it doesn't allow
Section 555.
Oh, good. Okay. Oh, good.
You got to have 50 acres to have your second, no, 15 acres.
See the farms? Should be allowed, especially.
It's a 50 acres.
Maximum density of farm supplement should be one farm.
So if you.
Oh, good. Okay, it's not a farm, then it clearly it's not for crops. Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
On the same page, too. The 552 and under farm supplemental dwelling, I go to the next page, but it's just because it's still farm supplemental dwelling. There's space for the members of the farm family, residential living space, or for other household for which a household member is employed on the farm. Now that's nice, but what if they're not one employed on the farm, or barely employed on the farm, or you rent it out? So how do we prevent that space, that supplemental dwelling, not becoming a rental? Hi, my children are working on the farm, but they're going to college, but they're renting it. Or they're not, like their friends are. How do we make sure that that happens?
Just like the in-law apartment.
Yeah, exactly, like in-law apartment.
When the in-law has passed away, now that apartment is a wall that the daughter put up, and now it's a rental unit.
And it can't be. We don't want the farm to have a rental unit, because we're not doing it as rental. So I'm a little concerned about the supplemental.
Yeah, that one, just so you know, that's been in the ordinance for 13 years.
Okay, so it's one of the problems that we're running into now.
This is not a change. Yeah, I mean, your concern is there, but I don't want you to think that this is something we just put in.
Mm-hmm. Right. What we're going to end up doing tonight, because we don't know we have a general feel for what's new. But it also gives an opportunity if there are any other issues or conditions.
The only example of that I can think of where it actually was used was where Magnolia Ridge Farm is now, which is on Tomacorg Road.
Yes.
When they bought the land, it had two, because it had been an Ananda church before that, and they had places where people could stay when they came there. So basically, they had to build, I think, of three houses on the property. And they were able to use this part of the ordinance.
To say that's legal.
I don't know that they have actually got anybody in there, but they used various parts of the ordinance, this ordinance, to allow them to have a farm. They were able to sell a couple lots out front. And I'm trying to think what section of the ordinance it was that they used for that. But anyway, I'm just saying the ordinance allow them to have a farm. They would not have been able to buy the land and put it into a farm. It probably would have been all house lots right now.
Yes, Al, you had a comment. You know, my only thought on this, and forgive me if it's been in the ordinance for this long, but zoning doesn't allow more than one dwelling on a piece of property. So how do we get to do this? You can't just write it into the ordinance. And with regards to Magnolia Ridge, I did that project. They went through the subdivision ordinance. No magic.
But they cut out, that's where they cut out some lots.
Yeah, so I don't think, I'm not quite sure that's the same thing. Not quite sure. I don't think you can do this.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, that's really.
Any other questions, concerns on it?
Oh, I have.
The minimum square footage.
Well, I have one 552. I'm 552. Yeah. And under farm related products, I assume that's also bakery items.
Also what?
Bakery. Bakery items, farm related products?
Yeah. And this is above.
Right?
Wouldn't that be
to add that in?
Yeah.
Well.
Also,
colonial. Yeah. And I'm also you have to remember, bakers have scents. You smell nice usually.
Oh, I know, bread.
So, okay.
Were you saying to add bakery on that?
Add business, that's what you're saying.
The last item I have, as long as it follows with the health, Rhode Island Health stuff. Department of Health. What I wanted to bring up is, and this is for the crop farm, but it also is in for large and medium farms and small farms. But anyway, what I was gonna bring up is, you know how it says, under 552, page one, under definitions of crop farm, the very last sentence, it says, you know, if you want to be a crop farm, you're gonna file with the IRS form, Schedule F. And then, you have to have earned at least 2,500 gross. Now, for someone who wants to do the crop, who's brand new, they gotta create something in 2 years and get some money in. And I disagree with that. I think that we want them, I think if you're gonna do it, how can they have had an income of 2,500 when they quote, they're not a crop farm yet, so.
I think most of the town has been just very gracious about that. I think with planning and zoning, they've given people enough time to try to earn their 2,500.
But it says you have to have earned it in the previous 2 years, and I don't think that's fair.
I think
or that makes sense.
But that's been there before.
I know, but maybe Harvey shouldn't be there.
I disagree.
No, I think.
Not in the preceding years, but going forward.
No, I think.
Yeah, you gotta see tax returns. How do you do it, you know, going forward? You can't, you need proof.
You need proof that
so
you're.
So you need to see the 1040s.
And you can do that. I mean, it's a business. It's not a fun and games thing. It's a business. It's a farm. It's a business.
Well, it's not a farm yet.
That's what I said. But it's calling it.
You know, people are farms without. I mean, there are people that have land and
oh, sure,
grow hay or whatever, and they may already have 2,500,
right.
Even though they never have. File as a farm.
So you don't see this as an issue then?
It doesn't seem to be an issue. Right. It's something that came down from the Division of Agriculture, you know, from DEM.
Mm-hmm.
That's their criteria.
Right. All right. The only other thing, if they file like a Schedule C instead of Schedule F, that's more what most people might do. And that still can be farm income, so that might not
What's
be.
What's the C and the F, should we?
Schedule C is more doing business as.
Oh.
It's a less formal process in terms of filing a tax return. So I know a lot of folks that do that. And that may be, maybe there's some way there that you can get around that Schedule F. You still have to record it.
So you know, I would say that, again, we had a group of farmers participate with us. We weren't telling them what we were going to do for them. We were asking them.
Right.
And what will work for you, mm-hmm. And none of them brought up that. Matter of fact, some of them said, I don't file with the state. We used to have it in there that you also filed, how did that go? There were people here that did not do the state reporting as a farm,
yeah.
But they did the federal. Mm-hmm. And so we took out the state because it's, before it said you had to have that to qualify, and there were people who said, well, I don't need to do that. So, and we didn't see any reason why it had to be in there.
Oh, there's federal. They have it under the federal.
So we, again, we were trying to fit this ordinance to work for them.
All right.
Okay.
All right.
Next page?
I was just going by number two, I guess. Does anybody else, I guess, let me just circle back to number one. Does anybody else have any questions, concerns about the crop farm? Reducing that square footage from 5 down to 2 acres. Any other comments, suggestions? Next one is we allow the new crop farms up to 600 square feet of retail floor area. Estill Farm at the corner of Main and Kanachi is an example of a crop farm. Do you want to increase that to square footage, I think?
Yeah, I'm a crop
farm. 600 is, I think, about what they have. Again, we ask questions, you know, what works for people. Be able to have a little bit of a barn, a little bit of your area you can show and sell some things from.
6 by 10?
Yeah.
600, no, 30 by 20 would be more like 600,
yes.
Mm-hmm. So we, frankly, we just asked, and 600 was half of 1,200, which is one other number, I don't know, it just seemed like it was a number that we can put on the table. It seemed like it would work for them. You can have a farm stand of 200 square feet, 10 by 20, I believe it is, already, and so this is just, you know, a step up from a farm stand that, you know, you can open the shutters and close the shutters on.
I have a question for you, Harvey. In your letter, you use the example of, let's see. I'm looking at your cover letter and number 1, 2, 3. Number 3, we double the retail area.
That's a mental typo. It's 2,000 in the ordinance, and I think Anthony was the one that said what would work. And 2,000 was the number we came up with, is that correct?
Right.
So the 2,400 is a mistake on my part. I caught it after I sent you the letter.
Okay.
I figured it would come out tonight.
All right. So is it supposed to be 2,000?
2,000.
And it's okay in the ordinance, as we said.
Well, one thing that Anthony said was, because this ordinance was fresh in place, I think, when they built their store, and he built it right to the 1,200 square feet, and they wish they could have built it bigger at the time.
And also, my understanding further on is that they would not count the kitchen or storage space as part of the 1,200, right?
Right.
All right. That's good. So it's now 2,000 minus kitchen and storage space.
2,000 plus
square foot.
Storage space. Right.
Yeah, plus. Without counting the kitchen and storage space.
So 2,000 square feet public.
Sounds good to me, Harvey, but again, we have the zoning regulations to deal with, right? I mean, I assume that if they want to expand their enterprise, they have to go through the proper procedures with zoning, right? I mean, I certainly don't know anything much about zoning, so, it sounds like a great idea to help folks out, but there's also a lot of other departments that intertwine.
Right. They want to, for instance, a good example of Lonely Farm, if you wanted, they have this smaller, they want it to be 2,000 feet, they would go to the building and zoning and pull a permit. That's how they start. They pull a permit and then they build their building. I don't think they have to go back to zoning or anything, or I don't know back to, I don't know if they ever had to go.
Well, there's, I'm trying to think, there's parking ratios that zoning has, all sorts of things that I expect to see.
Building and zoning would determine that.
But it's also,
I believe.
Yeah, you also had some, I was concerned about parking, but I thought what you had written in the ordinance was well considered on parking, on off-road parking, because I was concerned about that, but I liked what you had written on that. I have other before we get into the solar part, I have other questions just on the farm.
Yeah.
Farm based. Do you want to go any of the other pages or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I have
page in.
Yeah. Page 554. The farm based light manufacturing. I wanted to know if you could talk about that, and also the idea that the applicant is different from the individual partnership or corporation that has filed with the feds for the farm. Who is this person who does not, an individual partner or corporation that lives in our town? And what exactly do you mean by light manufacturing? And let me tell you where this is coming from, because I know you haven't considered it in particular, but I've been going to both planning and zoning, and one of our, a problem that I think has come up, and I consider it a pretty serious one, is marijuana growing in farm, our R80 and farms. I am very concerned about the retail, the farm products, being able to sell it when it incorporates hydroponic marijuana growing on an RFR-80, which we do have one now in front of our zoning board already, and hopefully that will pass. I personally think we have to ban marijuana growing operations in R1s and RFR-80s before we can move on with the farm viability ordinance. I like what you're doing on the retail. I like what you're trying to do, I think it's great, but if you put this in and marijuana is allowed in an agricultural area, we're going to have Mary Jane parties everywhere, and retail, and bakery. It is a major issue, so I would like you to remember, or I would like to certainly say that I would like this to go on hold until we officially ban them from RFR 80, from farm zones. Otherwise, everything you put in here, which is wonderful for farms, and I approve of it, I think it's great, is going to be a real problem when you start going hydroponic.
And this one right here is already in there.
Check.
So I hear what you're saying, and I think it sounds like we need to plug it a little bit.
Right, we need to really plug this up. And I certainly don't really appreciate an applicant who's a farmer, who is a corporation coming into town. We're not big enough to have a corporation. We're not Iowa. So I'm a little concerned on that. I certainly, on the next one down, letting four light manufacturing employees on the premises who are not members live there, I'm not sure how we need to look at all that. And number three, under farm-based light manufacturing, the machineries and materials are to be if stored outside, hidden from public view by topography or vegetation. But certainly what we're finding is that many people try to hide those things in the big storage trailers, the big ugly storage trailers, and they're saying, well, it's allowed. I don't want it allowed. I think it's really ugly, and I don't think that would be appropriate. So not a trailer box or whatever you call them. A vehicle at 30,000 pounds, I'm really not sure how big that is. I assume somebody knows because I don't. I certainly understand a tractor. I understand back loaders, but I don't understand massive dump trucks. So that's a concern. The other one is light manufacturing activity restricted to 7 to 7. This is in RFR 80 and R1 zones, so I think it should, I'd rather it was 8 to 5. I can understand how it might be 7, but certainly not till 7 o'clock at night. This is right next to R1 zone, so 5 p.m. should be
plenty. Where are you reading right now?
Page right after 554, just before 555. You have it in a couple of places, actually. You have the...
It's just above 555,
yeah.
Section.
So I have some concerns there. Also, as you continue, farm-based service businesses and farm products are two different things. Farm-based service is interesting. I mean, I'm actually interested in the weddings or the things that you can have on a farm. But I'm concerned about it in its party zone. And it's not the same as farm products. It's sort of in the same paragraph.
I will say that nobody among the farmers brought up anything like, events and weddings and stuff on the farm. So apparently it wasn't on any of their
minds. That's coming through on the state level.
It is.
I understand that, but I'm talking about the local group of farmers. I asked them at one point, is this something anybody is interested in? And there didn't seem to be any interest among the group of farmers that was working
but
with us.
We have the future, and I don't actually mind it. I think that it could be quite charming if they turned everything off by 10 o'clock. I think that could be very nice, and certainly can make a farmer a lot of money. I like the wine tasting and things like that. I think it's great. I don't think it's a bad thing, but I think we need to make sure as we go forward that they can do that, but they can do it within the regulations so we don't aggravate our horses and our cows that are sleeping next door.
We would have drafted something for that if anybody had expressed an interest, but nobody did, so we just said, well, let's let it ride.
Yeah,
I want to refocus the group here. I don't want to go through the whole farm viability ordinance and make amendments and changes or suggested amendments and changes. That's not what we're here tonight. Harvey sent us a letter outlining, I think, four items that they wanted to amend the viability. So we're going to kind of stay on point with these four items, and if they intertwine certainly with the ordinance that's currently in place, fine, but I'm not going to get into, we should do it on Tuesday and not Wednesday. I mean, it's just crazy. I can't do that tonight. We're just going to go through the four items, and again, as they intertwine with the ordinance, fine, but I don't want to go through and make all these suggested changes on all this stuff. It's not what we're here tonight. We're here tonight to introduce the four amendments and see how that affects the community and see what the council's thoughts are. So
those are my thoughts.
Anyway.
So
being said.
I do have a question, and just to make sure we're all on the same page. 555, where it says, section 555, farm supplemental dwellings, where it does say the maximum density of a farm dwelling should be one plus, blah, 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 and one additional. So that's not allowed. That's going out. Right? Everywhere where it indicates we're going to have another dwelling for the farmers doesn't work this way. Right, Al? That was your point?
I would say more accurately, someone needs to get the solicitor to confirm that this works or doesn't work.
Okay.
To me, it sounds like circumventing zoning.
Yeah. Okay.
To me.
Well, I will say that, you know, this is a zoning ordinance. It's allowing things that you can't do otherwise in RFR 80. Same thing as the solar that's allowed now in here. I mean, it was looked as a way to it's a farm viability ordinance. It was meant to assist the farmers, hopefully in a way that is appropriate
so,
and not damaging.
So what I'm hearing is, wherever it's in here, that is a possibility. We send it to legal, and it would be good for the council. I don't have a problem with this if it's allowed. You've got large farms that want to have a supplemental dwelling. It actually makes sense. So I'm not opposed to that. So we send it to legal and see what happens? Is that okay?
Yeah, I have concerns about it myself. I mean, what you did, Harvey, you had all the farms here. I was here for maybe one or two. That's dealing with now. Just like when we shut down the commercial thing for Spicer. It's not now that bothers me. It's what's going to happen in 10 years from now. And that's, I mean, I live in Hopkinton. We have on your bag, it says keep Hopkinton country. The thing is, I know we're trying to help the farmers out and regulate things in town, but we want, I do, and most people who moved into Hopkinton, because I asked them, I says, why'd you move here? You want a laundromat or a bank or something, why'd you move to Hopkinton? Well, I left the country setting. You give an inch, it's going to stop moving and snowballing. And my concern and what I look for is what's going to happen 10 years down the road. And that's what, I mean, someone always tells me that I'm too much of a chess player. Because I think if the next two moves pass what we're doing now. And that's what concerns me, is people circumventing, like Al said, zoning, and with these supplemental dwellings. Same thing I have issues with in-law apartments. What happens when the in-laws pass away? And I know of two of them that are not rented. And they are considered illegal apartments, but they were perfectly fine there. There's no one, we don't have enough manpower to check all this stuff. I mean, we have, and I'm going off a little bit, and I'm gonna stop after this, but we've sat here days, months, and probably over years, because Vinny started the gravel bank ordinance. And we have one gravel bank that's registered. Two? Oh, we have two now? Oh, okay. There was only one for a while, huh?
One's a gravel bank.
Right.
So, I mean, these are things that, I mean, we can pass all kinds of things, but if there's no, as time goes by, that's my concern, is the future of Hopkinton and keeping the country.
Ordinances that cover these items, the state's going to come in and decide for us. And that's the whole reason for getting local people involved in these changes. I see where you're coming from, Tom. I know. I mean, you have anybody watch the legislation this year? It was crazy. So.
Yeah, because like you said, they said there's something coming down from the Senate right now where they're going to pass something for venues on farms or stuff like that. I don't know if it's passed. I don't know if that did get passed or not.
She did not originate with farmers.
No, it's big corporations and now can have
big parties.
and parties and stuff like that.
I think we really need to think about the future for the farmers so that they are viable. And that because we know they butt up to R1, almost all of our farms do, is that they are able to dovetail with residential properties with children on it. And I certainly am very concerned about marijuana in all of our 80 zones. Not as concerned with manufacturing and industrial, but very much concerned with our 80. And this is the new ordinance, or the old ordinance with the new changes, sets them up. And I think that's a very large problem.
And does anyone have the, has anybody got an idea of whether or not marijuana is, it's got to get decided, I suppose it's going to get decided in court, but is it agricultural or not? Is it a farm-based product or not?
Pharmaceutical. It's not, they haven't,
well that's why
they haven't brought it in front of the courts yet. Certainly we have one now from the zoning.
It depends on what they grow, and you can grow industrial, that would be considered an agricultural product because it doesn't contain the THC or the psychoactive. There are certain, there's a whole, runs a whole gamut as far as different strains of marijuana, hybrids.
It has to do with no THC in them. It's not an opiate. Exactly, some are not, but some are.
No, they're not, Harper. I'm sorry.
But anyway, it doesn't matter if they're legal or illegal. Why are we looking at wind? And there must be a reason Is it more profitable? Is it easier? Can they manage it versus is it less land? I mean, what is it about it that you would prefer, the farmers would, if they prefer it, rather than solar? I know some of them are solar, but when it comes to the wind, I'd like to hear from you guys why.
Gary, let me speak up on that.
I'll take it. It takes up less land to begin with. Mm-hmm. Right? We can plant our crops right around the wind. That's number one. Number two, it pays more money than solar.
You have to speak up.
It pays more. Want me to stand up?
Yeah, you don't have to stand in the microphone.
Just come a little closer.
Just come closer.
It pays more money than solar.
Okay.
That's what it does.
Why is that? Does it generate more money?
It generates a lot more. Yeah,
so that's why it pays more.
I mean,
do you have any statistics or anything along those lines that you? I mean, how did you come to that conclusion? So, how high? You must have talked to the developers.
Oh, we got here. We had to talk about that. So those are two of the reasons. For us, I can tell you why we're looking at it. Simply this. Okay? We start out the story a little bit. Talked to a fellow one time down in Texas. Told him he had a dairy farm in Rhode Island. He says, that's impossible. Rhode Island ain't big enough for a dairy farm. He's right to a certain extent. Dairy farm, we need land, especially the new dairy farms. Our competitors that we compete against have thousands upon thousands of cows and factory farms, and we have to compete against them. We need something to level the playing field. I can't put 10,000 cows on my farm. I mean, this is California. Yeah, 10,000 would go down there. And everybody in town would hit me. Real quick. So we can't do that. So what we look at in the farm, where I see the dairy farm is going, is we do dairying and. Let's look around at the various farms. Lewis Farm over here in Connecticut, what do they do? They do dairying and gravel bank, trucking business. Right? Louis Escobar up in Portsmouth, Rhode Island, do dairying and he has a bed and breakfast, he does the corn maids. We have Kevin Green. He does dairying and windmills. We've looked at our situation. We're out in the middle of the woods. My phone was on Route 3, I'd be throwing an ice cream stand up real quick. It's, you know, selling ice cream, and that would be our end. We don't have that. And we need an and to continue on. So now, when windmills were sold, our thinking is going to, we're going to do dairying and we have solar coming. We do dairying, and if we get the wind, we do the wind. And we do dairying and we're going to go after a digester too. So the new will make electricity for that. And since we're way in the backwoods and nobody sees us, that becomes an ideal and for us. Help us continue on.
I'm not against wind at all. I think it's a really old form. I don't necessarily think it should be in the farm viability ordinance. I think it should stand on its own, and therefore you would use it for the farms. Because I think, like solar, it needs to have its own ordinance. It is its own space, because it can be commercial, not just farm. But then the farm viability ordinance should be able to access that ordinance and use it, because I do think it's a good idea.
And in reality, it's only on the farms. It's only the farms that have a lot of land, didn't you think? Mm-hmm. Right? Okay, I'll give you an example, right? I own 250 acres. How many windmills do you think I can put on 250 acres?
Probably more.
Two of them, lucky. That's it.
Why is it?
Hannah's right there. You'll tell you why.
Well, they can't. You can't put them close to each other because they disturb each other. They have to be a certain distance apart. That way, the turbulent air doesn't affect the other turbine. So they need, at the very, very most, Elm Rock Farm to have two.
And that's 250 acres.
Yes.
Yeah. Well,
because they got to look also when they lay it out. It's going to bother anybody.
Sure.
Right.
I mean, these people done a fantastic job looking over the whole thing. And so So, you know, when I first heard windmills, when I first heard the property tax, 250 acres, split 20 of them down there, that's a good deal. You know? And they, the land is lost. I said, put one right in front of the house. He said, no, we're not putting one in front of the house. He hates it. Says.
Yeah, Tom.
Gary, you mentioned solo, wind, and manure. Doesn't say anything in here what happens if you stop milking. Now, your energy production, and then it would be and milking. I mean, that's, what happens to all this if you stop milking cows? Because,
well, that's a question because of the fact we don't have it, we're going to stop milking cows. If we stop, I have another generation ready to go. Farming's another one. We're not getting rid of the cows.
You know, I mean, no, I was just, when you were just saying that, I was thinking, okay, let's reverse it. And I'm not,
well,
I'm
actually,
not thinking on you.
Depending
I'm thinking
on, the
on if somebody buys, it's the bus bomb right up here, number three.
You mean Harvard?
Yeah. Hardwood. You know, they bought Gray Farm from Matt Gray, and they turned it into a driving range. These are things that I've known that's happened throughout the course of my lifetime in living in Africa. And these are things that I think about going forward. I mean, I've seen a lot of things, I mean, most of us have lived here, Sylvia and I grew up here. Al, you've been here forever. Not that long, not that old. These are things that I try to envision.
What happens if, this is a question for the wind people. If someone puts a windmill up on a farm, and let's say he wants to sell his farm, maybe you just do, and you're going to make houses out of it. What can you do once the windmill is up if it's no longer a farm? How close can buildings or houses be to the windmill?
I mean,
or does that take that whole piece of property and it becomes unusable?
Well, really, it's truly as close as people want to live to it. I mean, if you go. This is not the point of this ordinance, and every farmer that I've spoken to in Hopkinton, is they're dedicated farmers, and they're trying to figure out how to support what they're doing, not the other way around. So, I mean, our first turbine that we installed was actually in North Kingstown, and when they first put up the turbine, there were two houses in the development, and they sold over 20 homes.
So they're
built.
Around.
Yeah.
So
not nothing due north of the turbine. Nothing due north of the turbine, but in other areas.
But I mean, so the turbine can fall, and no one's in the way, effectively.
There, I don't believe there's any houses in, except for the owners, in the fall down zone.
So other than that, you can build around.
Definitely.
That. Okay.
Let me just mention that the ordinance. It doesn't allow anything other than, say, a farm building, and not within the fall zone, which is 400 feet. And if you think about that, that's 800 foot across. I mean, you're talking about 15 acres or so, that basically, as long as that windmill is there, it can't be subdivided, it can't be developed. So it's really a temporary form of farm forest open space.
Sure.
Protection, you know, it's not going to be developed by the term is there. It's not 250 acres, but it's 16.
You talked about it being standalone, and what I would like to see happen is that we go to the 2011 document, and I don't mean tonight, we just got it, and Harvey has been given a copy. Anyone who is interested in getting it, it's the wind ordinance that was a draft wind ordinance
and it's draft number five, so the council back then did work on this. What I'd suggest is that planning look at this and also look at what you have, your planning board review, et cetera, on and on. And I bet that, I you know, I don't know, but I'm sure that there's some very similar items in here. I will say, though, that 400 feet, I don't even think it's allowed that you can build anything 400 feet up in the air because of airplanes. Is that true? Is it?
No.
Is that true anymore?
It's not 400 feet in the air.
You're not talking about it being 400 feet in the air?
No, that's the crash zone if it falls over.
No, but isn't it 400 feet in height, which is allowed in here?
So actually, I noticed that today. So the smallest turbines that are actually, the most built turbine in Rhode Island right now is actually 415 feet tall. The three that are located in Providence, mm-hmm. the 10 that are in Western Coventry, the one in North Kingstown, the one in Portsmouth High School, they're all 415 feet tall. That's the smallest certified tower. And we go through,
And that's to the tip of the blade.
So the tower is 280 feet, smallest certified tower.
Okay.
And then the blade standing up straight is about 415 feet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But FAA is, that's a process we have to go through, and we do for all of our projects anyway, so.
I didn't think anything above 200 feet was allowed.
You have to go through a more rigorous process, a longer process to get FAA approval, but it's allowed.
Okay. What's the one in Portsmouth?
The same. Well, so there's two.
415?
The one at the high school is 415 feet. Then there's the Portsmouth Abbey, which I believe is smaller. But that is an older technology that has a gearbox, so
correct.
It's different.
But I think the wind is an interesting one. I think it needs to be a separate ordinance. I think we can certainly start with the 2011 and see how it dovetails with everything you've done in farm viability, because it's a good thought, and I think that certainly the council's, at least I think most of us, are open to that and trying to get that accomplished.
So one thing it might do if it was in the farm viability ordinance is maybe it belongs in other lands. But it would certainly be an easier way to see how it's going, because it'd be a lot less rush to put them up, because there aren't a lot of farms that are going to qualify, I don't think, for this. And the other, another point on it too is trying to put some balance in act of because right now there's a limit of how much electricity from these alternative sources you can put into the grid, because it's not as easy as a typical power plant to, you know, turn on another burner or something, you know, and produce more electricity at the time you need it. So there might be some competition between photovoltaic solar and the wind energy, and trying to compare them, a 1.5 megawatt wind turbine produces approximately the same electricity as, depending on how you define, 8 or 10 acres of solar panels. So
could you stay on that, what you just said? Because that's actually one of my questions.
Yes.
If the same, you've got your turbine up, and you know that it's I guess 400, it's 800, whatever the land mass for your wires that hold it in place. You don't have
wires.
Well, that's right. There are no wires on that. So you just need to have enough space for the fall.
Correct.
So it's
but that can be in use. They can be in crops. They can be in.
Right.
Could be a barn.
But that's not my question. My question is, if you take the same space and you put your turbine up, how much electricity would that produce compared to if you put solar panels and use for solar panels the same space? Obviously, then you wouldn't be able to use crops and hay, you know, whatever. I'm just curious about the
equivalent.
Did you just say you would produce about the same amount?
I don't think so.
But you take up all the land. Maybe you have some statistics or actual.
Well, solar is very modular. They're literally called modules, solar panels. So you can make it as large as you want, but it's, I mean, we have 1.5 megawatt turbines, we have 3 megawatt turbines. The 1.5 megawatt turbines in Coventry are producing roughly 3 million kilowatt hours a year. And so for that same, we install wind and solar, I will say, but the solar, get the same production, you need 8 to 10 acres, depending on how much land you have to clear for shading, to get the same production, electricity, as a 1.5 megawatt turbine. So that's the, we don't at all count the fall zone, because it's completely usable land for the parcel that it's on. It's not, I mean, we have, Kevin Green said, don't plant anything under my turbines, I'm going to put corn there. So he's not, it's not out of production. Unless you want to, there's also landowners who keep their remaining part of their property in farm forest open space, so it's completely up to them.
So if you use the same amount of land
for
solar,
and
obviously then you can't use the land for growing crops and things, if you use the same amount of land that's now going to be used for the turbine, would they produce about the same amount, or actually the solar would be more?
It's kind of apples to oranges.
8 to 10 acres of solar.
8 to 10 acres of solar is 1.5 mega, whatever.
Oh, okay. Well, yes, it's 1.5 megawatts of wind, which is, it's like, the footprint of it is about like this. So it's you couldn't put, you can't pack turbines together.
They need
30 acres. If you have about 25 to 30 acres and you put a turbine dead in the center of it, that's one. So it needs a lot of land. It's kind of different.
It needs land for air, for wind.
Yes.
But it doesn't need land for ground.
It requires a lot of land, but it doesn't occupy a lot of land. So that land stays.
So you must be familiar with our land in general. You must be familiar with our town and land and where some farms are, whether or not a
couple.
I mean, from your point of view, being producing these turbines or making the work, I guess my question is how much. No, I think the question's already been answered. No,
there are a lot of large farms in Hoppington that have already sold development rights as well. So those are not farms that we would look at. That's not, we don't believe that's appropriate.
How's the wind? I guess they have wind in Warwick and Providence, but how is it here?
I know
Cranmer Field is usually pretty windy.
If you can go up high enough, it works. If you had to be below the tree level, it wouldn't work.
Right.
I thought they did a test years ago on North River.
That's what I wondered, if there are tests that you can.
There are, but because the projects are net metered, so you're offsetting someone's use. It's not like a power plant. You know, so I always use this example. Years ago, 2009, 2010, I worked for a much smaller renewable energy company. And we had a natural food supplier that called and said, I'm really interested in wind, find out the best site. Well, the best site from a resource standpoint was in Nebraska or something, but it wouldn't pay for itself there because they didn't have net metering like we do in Rhode Island that just got expanded recently. So they're offsetting, 5 or 6 cents a kilowatt hour, whereas here it's 15 cents a kilowatt hour because power is a lot more expensive in New England. And because you have the net metering program. So it does work financially. We're putting turbines in other areas of the state as well. And we think that it is a really good fit for farms specifically because, I've talked to farmers that get, so during construction of the turbine, we do take down trees, but then we put low growth if it is forested. But even on farmers where it's wide open already, they get mad if you need like a couple acres. Even somebody like Gary who has hundreds of acres, well, for a couple of months, we need a couple of acres and then we'll plant our corn back. They don't even want you to disturb that much. Like, they're so very much into what they do that it tends to be a better fit for farms that are active farms and want to continue to do what that, that's how they define themselves, so. I mean, Gary said he was approached by, like I said, we do install wind and solar, but specifically for working farms, it seems to be a much better fit. I know Gary said he was approached by a solar company, someone who just wanted solar, and we've talked to you about both as well, but you said, no way, not for that amount of land, I need that.
You don't take, no.
So.
Yeah.
So, sorry, while we have this skimming here, so we know that the wind is good in Hopkinton, and I heard us say we can get above the tree line, it's good, so how do we get to 400 feet?
So it actually, I would say that if you're doing 400, it really needs to be 415, or else you're gonna get towers that are modified, or they wouldn't have the same certification, which does compromise the warranty of the machines that you get here. So it really should be more like 415 feet if this is something that the town's serious about.
I wanna know why can't it be 200?
It can't be 200 because they don't produce the amount of electricity to make the project work.
Is that because they're not tall enough, so they aren't
not tall
getting
enough.
The atmosphere?
Yeah, so they don't even make turbines that are that small anymore at commercial scale. So there's the 1.5 turbines that were installed in Rhode Island, it's the most built technology in the world. The German company actually licenses their technology out to multiple other companies as well. And they're basically done developing the 1.5 megawatt turbine. They've got to a point where it's reliable, it has a very long warranty, and they're building 3 megawatt projects now, and they're trying to go to 5 megawatt projects. So that's 1.5 megawatts is really the bottom range of the sweet spot where it makes sense. They're direct drive turbines, and there's multiple factors that define how a wind resource becomes productive, and one of them is roughness. So there's the ground, and then there's kind of the artificial ground thing, like hills and trees and things that actually can make the air rough. And turbines don't use that air wisely; it needs to be up in the prevailing wind. But that's exactly part of the reason that the footprint is so small, because it's up in the air where it's actually making the energy.
So these turbines that are kind of cropping up around the ground, are they all net meter?
I would say so. 1, 2, 3, 4. Most of them are. Some of them are in the 5 that I know of are in the renewable energy growth programs, like a lot of the solar projects that you're hearing. So that's the program where National Grid buys the renewable energy for a set amount of time. Yeah. But most of them are net meter. Yeah.
I assume that from the farmers in town, is the net metering what they want, or is it actually revenue? Is it net metering and
it's different. So the farmers, in this case, I'm sorry, excuse me. The farmers would just get the lease payment. So the power, actually, it's called remote net metering.
Oh, okay.
So in Rhode Island, there's certain entities that can actually buy the power from a turbine and offset their own usage. So like 3 of our wind turbines in Coventry are actually owned by the town of West Warwick. And they're offsetting all of their electricity consumption with turbines that they own remotely. So that would be the setup.
Coventry gets the lease? Things.
On the land that they own, yes. But there is also a, there's also a tax that passed last year, which was a tangible tax, right?
Tangible.
So it was a tangible tax, and it's much like you, Hopkinton's entitled to this for all renewable energy projects, but it's $5 per kilowatt. And so for a 1.5 megawatt wind turbine, it's this much room, but it's $7,500 instead of much more acreage for a similar amount. So.
What about noise?
Hmm?
What about noise?
Sorry.
So they're not gearboxes. What are they?
It's a permanent magnet.
Okay.
So, I mean, they do make some noise. If it's far enough away, you don't hear it. And I would say that the work that the Conservation Commission has done on this draft ordinance certainly protects the town and neighbors from any adverse impacts. noise and flicker. So I mean, they do, I'm not gonna say they don't make noise, they make some noise, but it's not mechanical noise. It's like a, it's a
whoosh
when it passes, when the blade passes the tower. And I'd also welcome anybody who's interested to, if you wanna go see them, we'd certainly host a field trip at one of our sites.
But is there a decibel limit to so many feet? How far out?
And that's up to you, it's...
No, yeah. What is the decibel limit now?
Industry standard, you mean?
No, what is the noise level at your 800 foot mark? Or 400 foot mark or something like that? I mean, I'm looking, if you're gonna put one in a certain farm that's available,
yeah,
I wanna know how far
the noise
you're gonna hear that noise.
Right.
Because it's not like something that can be shut off.
Right.
I mean, this is gonna be running.
Yeah.
24/7.
So I believe in the ordinance they regulated it at the property line, and the reason that that's important is because, or either at the property line or at a receptor, and the reason that that's important is because if you have, it'll prevent turbines from being somewhere where a neighbor could be bothered by the noise. So it's calculating the decibel level at the closest either property line or receptor, whichever,
The way we did it was 45 decibels, and we find it either the property line or area under the control of the wind turbine close. In other words, we know of examples such as up in West Greenwich, in Coventry, and stuff where they actually purchased a contract with a neighbor or something to smooth the way so that you know they're willing to allow for some money, they'd be willing to put up with some flicker or some noise. But the noise we put in was 45 decibels at whatever that official limit is. And I think you were
that's right.
That's a pretty low number.
That's a low number, that's good. I think Tom is right. It is a 24-hour noise. Solar is basically a 12-hour noise or 16-hour max. So the 24-hour does make a difference. But I know I have been at the Portsmouth one where they put it up, and the whoosh sound is actually a pretty sound. It's not obnoxious at all, actually. And that's the older version, which would be noisier than the new versions,
right.
I guess. And it wasn't, and it was in the middle of a campus. And, you know, kids and monks and people like that are living there, basically almost right under it.
Oh, that was the Abbey, yep.
That was the Abbey, of course, with that. But it was not obnoxious at all. It's kind of interesting sound.
Well, I guess we do certainly have the initial groundwork for that wind ordinance. It's something we can certainly revisit and get that going.
I'd like to just mention one other thing. You said it before, but I'm not sure if it was we're all on the same page. Maybe we won't be all on the same page, are we? But from the best way I can understand it, a wind turbine, which occupies, as far as I'm concerned, on a farm, almost zero space, because it's just like a pole.
Yeah.
Does the equivalent of what 10 acres of farmland would otherwise do with solar. So to me, that for farm, that's just a huge argument in favor of, if you're gonna do one or the other, to do it this way. So the farms can be farmed. I was very concerned with the loss of 60 acres of prime agricultural soils. Who knows why it's this way in Hopkinton? And that's prime agricultural soil, so it's got trees on it, of course. Yeah. I mean, it's just,
it makes sense there.
But that's the way it is here. But that's the future for farming, when farming might be extremely important, more so than it is now.
I don't know, it was 1951, the huge fire we had here. And it came all, I don't know how far past Lawton Foster, but all of that, Arcadia, up to Lawton Foster, that whole forest.
Talking about that.
that fire, and how long it took for the trees to be back. So the tree, it is relatively in the forest, I guess you could say. There were some big trees that survived the fire, but most were gone.
50 years, what, 6 years old? We don't have huge mature forest. We don't have old forests, we have mature forests, but they're not truly old and fabulous like those elms used to be in Hope Valley. I wish we had that.
Now, I have another interesting perspective, being a farmer, the way you look at things, right? Remember, I told you, size matters in farming, where we're going, right? We started figuring out, how does the windmills compare to the cows? Windmills replace 100 cows, 100 plus cows. So I have to milk 100 less cows to get where I'm going.
You mean monetarily?
Yes.
Okay.
That's good.
Yeah, it is good, because I'm dealing with NRCS, I'm dealing with pollution, I'm dealing with all of that down there with the new barn. 100 less.
Hey, I grew up on a farm, so I know. And eventually the dairy went. But we sold everything. Wood, strawberries, eggs. I mean, you know, you do everything you can to keep your farm alive.
But the windmills, by doing that, instead of us having 250 cows, we can have 150 cows, and it's still the same income.
Have you talked to like the Lewis Farm in Connecticut, where they just cut down all the trees, a huge amount of cut down the corn in the middle of the field right on 95? As you come,
I didn't know what that was all about.
Yeah, they bought the corner of Old Bridge and 184. Yeah, they cleared that. It's all hay now.
It's all hay and corn. It's corn now, but it's right there on the edge. And I was, but that'd be fun to see. In the middle of the cornfield.
See, that's the problem with farming in New England. As the farms get bigger,
yeah.
I mean, I came up, last time we had a meeting, I started talking about the solar collector. My concern is we have to go off the farm and begin renting land.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I need 1 tilled acre per cow I got down that farm to feed that cow.
You don't have to kill all your trees, darling.
Yeah. No, I don't want to kill all my trees. I want to be able to, that's why I'm talking windmills, so we don't have to have as many. Right? And what we're looking for, you know, you got to be able to feed your cows. That's first and foremost. That limits your size right there, is your feed. If you buy your feed, you don't make any money. And you have trouble finding other farms on the side.
Do you know if any, we used to hay every little field everywhere, all over town. Not Ashway, but it was the middle and mostly Hope Valley area. Behind Mon Haas, the land back there, up on 138, where your uncle lives, there's a couple of fields. I mean, these little fields, it was worth it because we go to one, we hay them all. So that's all we did with them. We hay, didn't plant anything. And people didn't care because we cut it and they let us have it and they were happy. So I don't know if anybody's even haying down there at all, or is people just mowing like your uncle's, it just gets mowed, you know?
You have part-time people that take the smaller fields. A lot of them, they turn around and they sell it.
Yeah, I think Harvey stated this, and I'm very interested in this, that we, I don't know if we keep it in the farm viability ordinance, but by doing it for the farms, one, it controls it. And we just don't have it just willy-nilly everywhere because they need so much land to be able to put it there. I mean, I would want to personally, I mean, I think they're neat as I'm driving through Pennsylvania and they're all on the mountains and so I'll check those out. But to go by it every day, I don't know if I'd be so inclined to want to see that. I don't know if I'd like to see it in next to Hartwood Farm, but what's his name on the other side? It's just 400 feet in the air. I mean, it's just not something that I think is a country thing.
Yeah.
But with Gary, with the amount of land he has, and it can be put back somewhere, I wonder if that might be some way to go to test the waters, per se.
I think that's what you would basically said. Before we open it up to just everything.
I think across the board planning is looking at it as well, is when we do solar or we do wind, the
but we try to tuck it as far back as we can and try to keep it masked from most people going up and down the roads, even when they're trying to do the small ones on farms, they're trying to get them so they block, so we don't have to look at them. And I do think that's important. I think ultimately going by a 400-foot, then you're probably just going by a telephone pole. You don't even notice it anymore.
Well, I mean, look what we've done at Exit 1. I mean, with Ray Clinton. We wanted to develop the manufacturing, the interstates that we did. Back when did that all start? I mean, way back when the big box days, okay? And the businesses that we put in there, we tucked things away. I remember telling American Coon, we want your business, we want your taxes, I don't want to see it. So that's, I mean, we painstakingly looked at that area to tuck those things back out of the way so it doesn't change the character. I don't want Route 3 to end up at Bald Hill in Warwick. I want to keep Ashaway and Hopkinton as rural as possible. So that's why I think it may be some way to do with the farms to tuck these things away. I mean, when I went up to Greg's greens, I was like, wow, look at that. That's pretty neat. But to see it every day, I don't know if that's something that I'd really appreciate.
Should be the power plant though, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. That's why this is happening.
Yeah. Well, we have a lot of work ahead of us, I guess, to kind of bring these things.
So I like the idea of this being a standalone ordinance, and the other changes we made to the farm ordinance is fine, but I think that we should have the planning look at this one too, and look at this, and combine the two. Is there anything in what the conservation has for wind that is not covered or is covered in here? I mean, there's so much more to this other ordinance, just the wind. But anyway, whether it happens or not, I mean, I shouldn't say happens or not, it looks like we're moving forward. And that's what I think planning did it before, so we think we should look at it here now.
One more question, sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
As I look through, a few things catch my eye.
Yeah.
What is the life expectancy of a wind turbine?
The life expectancy is 25 years.
Okay, so it's similar to solar.
I just wanted to add one thing, if I may, just to keep things in perspective. So I have not seen the draft of 2011, but just for your perspective, there were no, I think besides Portsmouth Abbey, which may have been up in 2011, I don't think there were any commercial turbines installed in Rhode Island.
Oh, right, that's so true.
Things have changed dramatically, and it goes from the stage of being able to be around a commercial wind turbine, observe it, learn about it. That's why the owner of our company has one in his front yard. He knows more about that turbine than anybody because he's out, it's literally in his front yard. So if it's making a funny noise or something, he tells the manufacturer. But things have changed very much. So it goes from writing an ordinance, guessing what's gonna be proposed, to being able to observe and study what's here. So I think that, and like I said, I have not read the contents of the 2011 draft, but I think that what the Conservation Commission has been working on is more kind of reactive to what's here rather than proactively picking from literature and things like that. So I would say that take that information as you will, but there's been a lot of work done and it's current.
Why don't you take a look at it too in the draft and see what that. If you have a copy
of
it.
Yeah, this section talks about guy wires.
Yeah. Which there really aren't.
Yeah. No, there aren't any.
There's one actually in Tiverton at Sandy Woods Homes, but it's not something that will likely be built again. I think they've been having a less than stellar time.
What happens when it breaks down? I had heard early on when it started that there were troubles and they couldn't get parts because things changed so fast.
So the turbines that are being built in Rhode Island now, the manufacturer actually
moved their operations maintenance office for the United States to North Kingstown. They have garages full of parts. But the turbines, they, first of all, they have 10-year warranties with option to extend. And they, that means that if the turbine is down for any reason, the manufacturer can pay the owner of the turbine the entire time that it's down, and it's, they pay it at a premium. So what that means is that they have a lot of motivation, if anything goes wrong, to get it running immediately. But these, the turbines, they're, we did a lot of homework before we decided to bring these to our state. They are fleet across the world is running at 98 or 99% availability all the time, which doesn't mean it's windy all the time, but it means that they are available to run all the time, which means they're not broken. So that's something that was very, very important.
And these don't have the gearbox, they have the magnetic.
They don't have the gearbox. The goal was, how do we make sure that nothing like what happened to the town of Portsmouth ever happens again?
Portsmouth Abbey has the gearbox.
No, the Portsmouth High School. So Portsmouth Abbey does.
Abbey has the gearbox.
But that, yes, the
Portsmouth High School has the problem.
Right.
That's one broken.
Right. And so we actually took that turbine down, removed the foundation, and put up a brand new turbine in the exact same location, but used one of the permanent drive turbines instead of the gearbox. And it's the same. And we actually own and manage that turbine, and they buy the power from us instead. So the town has no management associated with it, which would be very similar to anything that we would install now.
Harvey, anything else from your group, I guess?
Well, so we covered basically four categories of things, two of which related to the crop farm. And I've heard at least two members, maybe three of you, thinking that you should separate out the ordinance. And I heard Tom making a kind of a comment that where did I hear? I think it was something that you know, it'd be nice to ease into it sort of with the farms.
That's
and
wind.
We're talking wind.
Wind. I'm sorry. Yeah. The wind. And I'm, you know, I'm kind of rooting for that side a little bit, only because I know how tough the farmers are having it, and I would like, if anybody's going to have them, I'd like to see it start with them. And I think they've got
some ways
to tuck it away too. And you know, but it, so anyway, that was the part. It, you know, it's, but I understand your reasoning on what you're saying as well. But I would love to see it done in such a way that the farms, if anybody gets them, it's the farms get the, you know, like the first
credit. Right,
because it will make a huge difference to them.
Have you ever, I've thought of it, but I never did it. It seemed that over the few five, six or more years, in the Westerly Sun, I've read articles every now and then about what North Stonington is doing for their farmers. And it seemed that they were very proactive. And I don't know if anybody here knows much about North Stonington. I'm curious about some of the things they have done in their community.
I called North Stonington to get some more information on it, and actually the people I spoke to didn't know where to find it.
Oh.
So I don't know whether it's a new person in the position or something, but I tried to do that.
Well, we can make some more inquiries, but like you said, we talked to farmers. I assume farmers talk to farmers quite a bit, and you know, North Stonington is, you know, just a stone's throw away, so I imagine they share stuff back and forth, but that sounds like a pitch for us to go find some more things to put into
the. But by the way, the question I had and still have, we came here, we talked about it outside a little bit. I don't, because solar does take land, it takes down trees, but you can tuck it away. This you can't tuck away. It's going to be seen by an area. I don't know what that area will be or how far, but it will be seen, it'll be heard to a certain extent by somebody. So I just, is this thinking down the road, is this really something we want for our town? We have to think about that. And knowing, however, that we want the farms to survive, we want that, we don't want them to be so difficult. It's hard work all the time, 27 days a year, just all the time, 7 days a week. And goes on and on and on. Farmers don't take vacations. It's usually something that's a rarity, real rare. It might go once in your life, but anyway. So that's still a question, and I don't know.
Well, that's very
interesting. I don't know the answer. The young people, because you and I, all of us, grew up with a certain mindset about certain things. Mm-hmm. Ask the kids; it's their future.
Yep.
You know, I don't think you're going to
have a child from the
school.
Yet.
I think
that
it wouldn't hurt. For instance, under President's report, you could, at the next council meeting, just give a report, a simple report, that the council had a workshop, what it was about, what we're looking at. It's and the film, and the camera's playing, and people at home, there's some people that watch it, and so we want word to get out. We want to hear from people. People don't know. For the most part, everything seems to be going along okay, so they're not too worried about the council, because we kind of, we're doing okay. But all of a sudden, they're going to see that, and they're going to be like, what happened? Where did that come from? How did that happen? Well, it's always that way. Well, I didn't know there was a meeting. We got to do our best to get the word out. That's all.
We have a lot more work to go, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. But it's a good start. It's a very good start. And there's a lot.
Any other questions from the audience?
Part of my job down on the farm that I see is being able to convince the next generations down that this is a viable living.
And it's worth it, yeah.
And it's worth it.
Yeah.
Honest work.
Yep.
And it's worth doing. And, years ago, what you did with your farm kids, you just kept them uneducated, so they didn't have a place to go. I mean, unfortunately, my kids are educated.
Right.
But the good part is they've worn out. They see what's out there, now they're thinking about it. My daughter, the fashion designer, is saying, I'm coming home with their farm.
Science.
And she's serious thinking about it. But,
that's actually very true. My mother was raised on a farm, and when she was 13, her father pulled her out of school because a good farm girl didn't need an education, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. And so, yes, that's true. And they have to get, the farmer's children today have to know they have to have that education.
Well, my feeling is with my grandchildren, I got a grandson that wants to do this. He's going to college. He's going to get a degree in dairy herdsman. It's a 4-year degree. And that's exactly what he's doing if he wants to do it, because I really feel it's gotten so sophisticated, you have to have that.
Or an agriculture business degree, so he can spread.
Yeah.
But yes, you're absolutely right.
Any other council comments, you guys? Okay. I guess to be continued. Thanks everyone for your input, and we appreciate it. We'll take it and move forward. Thanks.
And anybody who wants a copy of this, the town clerk will have the old draft, 2011.
Okay, workshop's closed. Thank you.